Guest lecturer, Professor Ha-Joon Chang, ladies and gentlemen seated in Cape Town and all those joined in this event virtually. Good afternoon. I'm deeply honored to have been asked to welcome all of you and to say a few words at this special event to mark the anniversary of the death of our leader and dear friend and comrade, Professor Ben Turok. It is indeed an honor because Ben Turok and I were not just members of the same political party. We had a deep friendship that spanned two decades, and we have shared thoughts and many ideas on how to transform our newly liberated country. And when you have a friend that you admire and respect, the relationship is all the more special. His sharp intellect, cutting analysis, fearless action to take those in power to task, the vocal stand he took on issues, and his unwavering quest for a fair political system and social justice are what won him admiration and respect. He was an outstanding individual, but one never divorced from the organizations that represented people from all walks of life, workers, and the unemployed, students and youth, farm laborers and domestic workers. Ben's life was a magnificent example of how we should fuse the theoretical with practical involvement in the cause for the political liberty, economic emancipation, and social justice. He qualified as an engineer, but his passion was political economy. Engineers create and build infrastructure for the betterment of society and its people. Ben did exactly that with his expertise and knowledge of political economy. For him, it was never about being an ivory tower professor. He was actively engaged in organizing and mobilizing people to build a new society for all, but especially for the marginalized and disempowered. He was actively involved in struggle and mobilization of the people for over 70 years, in fact, for most of his adult life. His activism went back as far as the 1950s. He wrote some of the economic clauses of the Freedom Charter and helped organize the Congress of the People. He was engaged in underground activities which landed him in prison for a number of years. When he was released, he was placed under house arrest. He was not going to accept being prevented from carrying on his political work. He was not that sort of person, and he secretly escaped and made his way across the border. Then came all his years in exile. He was an academic, a lecturer. He wrote and did research and shared his skills and knowledge with young people. But he continued his work for the ANC. And when eventually he returned to South Africa, he threw himself into the process of transformation. He will be remembered for his contributions to the writing of the Constitution and for his efforts to implement the Reconstruction and Development Plan. He showed the same determination in his next defining role as a member of parliament in our democratic dispensation. He was one of the MPs who read the masses of paperwork that came his way, and that was not enough. He read even more, learned what he could, and made sure was fully informed on matters before parliament. He prided himself on that, and he didn't just sit back. That was not Ben. He asked questions. He spoke out. He challenged decisions. he stuck with his principle. We remember his stand on the information bill. He refused to vote for it. That is the Ben Turok people will remember. And of course, he didn't confine his work to sitting in parliament. He was very active in the different constituencies he was assigned. For him, being a member of parliament was about working at grassroots, listening to the people, and looking after the interests of those he was put there to represent. He didn't stop at that. Not content with just holding political office, he re-established the Institute for African Alternatives, an organization he had founded in the early 1980s when he was in exile in Tanzania. He saw a role of IFAA in social and economic transformation and commissioned research, held conferences and seminars, and created forums for university students to question prevailing ideas about South Africa, the continent, and the world. He would be pleased to see that IFAA is still doing that work today, 2 years after his passing. He also launched New Agenda, a journal where matters of political, social, and economic policy could be raised and examined. Ben would receive a stream of visitors at the IFAA offices or at his home. All sorts of individuals came to him for advice and information, diplomats, students, visitors from abroad. He welcomed them and talked to them, sharing his views and his knowledge. And if they didn't come to him, well, Ben being Ben would call on them. He contacted the CEOs of the most powerful companies in South Africa and asked for an appointment to discuss their role in economic transformation. If he had still been with us during last month's local government elections, I have no doubt that he would have been vociferous in calling on people to exercise their right to vote and in reminding candidates that their duty would be to attend to the needs and problems of the people. My friendship with Ben was grounded at first in the excitement of the transfer of political power, and we discussed and shared ideas on how to bring about transformation and just and fair redistribution. In the last few years of his life, we were deeply concerned about the destruction being wrought by the appallingly high levels of corruption. Ben didn't hide his contempt for those who abuse public office and showed no fear of rebuking them in public. For me, his passing was not only a personal loss, it was also a loss for the country of a public persona who exposed those who swim in the murky waters of false promises and hypocrisy. Ben is probably the last of that noble generation of leaders whose hallmark was their complete dedication to a free and just society. And he practiced the high ethical and moral standards he expected of the leaders in their personal and public lives. If there is one expectation I have of this inaugural event and the ones that will follow in the years to come, it is that it will give us a platform to highlight the ideals and principles of the liberation movement since its founding at the turn of the 19th century. May this event and the lecture by Professor Chang inspire those attending to take the road that Ben Turok walked and become selfless citizens committed to being a caring society living in harmony with nature's laws. I regret that I cannot attend this auspicious event, either virtually or in person. This recorded message is the only option that was available to me to express my solidarity with all of you. I've been asked by the African Union to oversee the elections in the Gambia. I commend IFAA staff and trustees and those from the University of the Western Cape who collaborated with IFAA for organizing this event, and hope that it is a resounding success in every way. Warm regards to Ms. Turok and her family and all those in attendance, and I thank you for your kind attention. Program Director, the Turok family.
In the direction he has. You know, we see the history of social radicalism and committed to social justice, and also on the main. We'd like to thank the other colleagues here who are welcome. We don't use now in the past as CWs. That you're always looking and drive that engagement for us now more than any other time. On behalf of the university, I'd like to welcome you here, but more than that, too. So see in which way that we as a community can support the work that is being done here, and one of the ways that we bring to the partnership with IFAA, which we are really, really lucky to be involved and connected with. I want to have a message from our rector and Vice Chancellor of Victorious. A recorded message, and then also want to welcome those colleagues from UWC and elsewhere who are on the Zoom chat. Colleagues, over to you.
Professor Ha-Joon Chang of the University of Cambridge, who is our keynote speaker today, members of the Turok family, Dr. Sunait Mulla, Director of the Institute for African Alternatives, Professor Julian May, Director of the Center of Excellence in Food Security, my colleagues from the Institute for Social Development at UWC, guests, colleagues, and friends. Welcome. South Africa has been blessed with many men and women for whom the ideals of equality, justice, and freedom were the driving forces in their lives. Ben Turok was such a man, and it is therefore fitting that we honor him today with the inaugural Ben Turok Memorial Lecture in partnership with the Institute for African Alternatives. For Professor Ben Turok, personal sacrifice and the denial of his own freedom was a cost he willingly paid, and this is evident when you look at his life during apartheid. Detained, hounded by the security police, and exiled for refusing to give up to his unwavering belief that our country should belong to all who live in it. His contributions are widely acknowledged and remembered, and this includes helping draft the economic clause of the Freedom Charter that said, the people shall